Okay, I think everybody is ready now, to some extent. Quick introduction. I'm Chris from Wir machen Boden. My username is pretty stupid, U7Angel. I use VVV since 2004, I think, quite a long time. And I quite had a lot of fun with bullet physics. My co-host is...
Hi, Thomas.
Question: who didn't attend the Box2D workshop yesterday? Raise your arms. Can you introduce yourself? Starting there.
Okay, I'm walking. I'm Carbon Hellwine.
Who else didn't attend the Box2D workshop? What's your previous experience with PVA?
Sometimes with PVA, it's been like 10 years and depression, but
okay,
not regularly.
So quite intermediate.
I'm Benjamin, I'm a designer and artist from Italy.
I'm from Argentina, I'm a lawyer, and I work for the
okay. Yeah, many years.
Who else don't we know?
Well, I'm Manuel from Argentina too. I work with four painters for several clients, and I like him today, of course.
I'm Jan from Belgium, and I use VVV for
Is there an absolute beginner here? Like, really doesn't know spreads and stuff. It's absolutely brilliant. So we're gonna manage a lot more stuff to do. So yeah, who you are, we've introduced ourselves. Next thing is, what is bullet actually, what's it for? What can you do with it? As the name says, it's a physics engine. It helps you basically animate things, simulate things, collide things, destroy things, work with springs, define cars or vehicles. You can work with soft bodies, with hard bodies, stuff like that, basically. It's a collision system, I said this, useful for games, animation and simulation. It's sometimes used for even for just still graphics, like to simulate some sort of like behavior and to put some objects in, like organize some objects by itself and get some still graphics out of that. I've got some pictures to illustrate the use cases. Of course, here you see a screenshot of a game where something is destroyed. This is usually animated or simulated by a physics engine and rendered by the render engine. This kind of stuff you can do with it. I've done this actually. One day I've tried to do this kind of structure and I realized it's pretty hard to actually program it myself. So it's a lot easier to like just generate balls and let them find their own position by itself, by the physics system. So this would be a use case. Of course, car physics is something I care a lot about because I like do lots of exhibits, simulating cars, showing cars, talking about car technology, stuff like that. And the fourth example is simulation. If you want to simulate like scientific data, behavior, knowledge, you can simulate fluids to some extent or some real world behavior to some extent. Saying that, the bullet engine is maybe not perfect for this kind of scientific simulation because it's more aiming at the game industry. If I'm not mistaken, it was developed by Sony Entertainment. I might be wrong. Does anyone know? Maybe, I've read it somewhere. So it's used in a lot of games. I think Unity used it, the Unity game development. It's used on the PlayStation 4 for several games. So it's actually a game physics engine, mainly. We distinguish inside Bullet between two kinds of worlds now with this current release. We have two worlds, like one is called rigid world and the other one is soft world. The difference between the two worlds is basically the rigid world can only simulate like really rock solid bodies, while the soft world can simulate rock solid bodies and soft squishy bodies. That's the distinction. A world basically defines a simulation. You can have more than one simulation in your VVV patch, so usually you have just one because you want everything collide with each other and build your world, but theoretically you can use more than one world to animate things. Told you why we have different worlds. The thing about gravity. Gravity is defined in VVV and in the physics engine by the y, x, y, z axis, by a vector. So basically, usually what you set up is like the gravity on the y-axis by -9 or -9.8. But you can actually do some other stuff. You can say gravity goes up, gravity goes to the side, whatever. You can sort of simulate wind with it to actually move force bodies around. The thing about time step. We will later see that we define the time step in the rigid world. This basically defines the frequency of calculation because the calculation can't be, of course, infinite. It has to be in some sort of steps, and that introduces some sort of problem because when you have like really fast moving objects, basically the physics engine sees the object in one frame there and the next frame there. And if there was a like really thin wall in between, it might happen that the bullet doesn't collide with the thin wall. There are tricks around this problem, but you have to be aware of that, that things can go through something, fall down through something, so it's not perfect. It's always like some sort of approximation what's actually going to happen in the physics engine. It's kind of fakey to some extent. Yeah, rigid body, it's a typical rigid body, a marble ball. It's hard, it's not flexible. Rigid body can come in all sorts of shapes. Box, sphere. BVH means like basically you can load a mesh from Cinema 4D, for example, and say it's a rigid body. Usually you use that for a landscape, for example, to walk around. You've got height field, which is pretty similar to a landscape, and you have got capsule, which is usually the collision body for a person, which walks on the landscape. What's pretty new in the recent release in the bullet implementations are all these kind of things, like dynamic properties, motion properties, get body transform. They make your life really, really easy. It's like that simple now to like actually define the physics model because it looks so much more structured than the early bullet release which I was working for some years with. Now it's like really, really simple. We're gonna look at vehicle and we're gonna look at force. What we don't look at, unfortunately, is soft bodies because in the current release it's like taken out again because there's a revision going on because the old soft body implementation wasn't like really working, wasn't perfect. So Vox is currently like looking at soft bodies and trying to fix that and give the whole framework an overhaul to make it really simple to work with soft bodies. But seeing this, this is quite enough stuff we have to talk about today. So it's three hours is quite a short time to actually cover all this. One thing I haven't mentioned yet is, apart from rigid bodies and soft bodies, is constraints. So basically you can tie objects together in a certain way. Like you have got left typical constraints are like a hinge to make a door, for example, or you've got a point-to-point constraint, which is usually used for picking things. Like when you want to pick a 3D body with your mouse, you usually do that indirectly with a constraint. You don't grab the ball by the mouse, but you actually generate a point-to-point constraint and pick the object by constraint. I'm talking really fast. If you have any question in between, just raise your arm. The last slide is about complexity. What game engines usually do is they don't simulate with the original mesh. So if you have this kind of like Starfighter, it's like it's kind of a complex mesh. But this isn't used for collision and stuff. We usually use some sort of abstraction for the collision model. So that's basically the reason why are we simulating just capsules and boxes and spheres. Because usually what games do is they use these kind of simple objects to simulate, but they render something else. So that's the difference between the two, basically. Yeah, you have different levels of like complexity. Yeah, this the original model and this is like the abstraction, which is usually enough. It's not like perfect. It's a bit fakey, but it works. It looks right when things collide. So. Where's my folder?
One quick question is that constraints can be also used for fluid simulations, or is it only
for what?
Fluid simulation.
Constraint is usually basically to construct like physical things, like a door or
okay. So it's not like
fluids usually
some more elements constrained to each other so they become fluid.
You can do that, but it's quite, I guess it's really CPU intensive and really hard to set up. What you usually do is like when you try to simulate fluids, that the one simulation screenshot which was showing it, you simulate even more like little balls, like a lot of them with kind of friction and restitution, and you are with the right setup, you get some sort of fluid simulation with that. Because you simulate balls, on the other hand, but this is not what you render. You can get basically the boundaries of that simulation and sort of turn that into a fluid rendering.
Is there a spring constraint?
There is, but not yet implemented. Not anymore.
That would be the soft body, right?
Yeah, exactly. Now, there are basically a lot of constraints. I've gave you the... I'm pretty sure I did. Yeah, the bullet user manual. This is basically the library description, and it says everything about like what constraints are possible in theory, but most of them are not implemented yet.
Sorry, you mentioned earlier that this kind of physics is used them with the Unity.
It is. It is basically a library which is used in several programs.
Okay, but you use the physics of bullet physics from VVV in Unity or just the?
No. The library is basically implemented into VVV, and the library is implemented into Unity.
Okay.
There's no interconnection between VVV and Unity.
So is it possible to work with, I don't know, a political physics engine and something like the Cinema 4D?
Cinema 4D has a physics engine built in 2 as well.
Okay.
Actually, the one screenshot I was showing with the sphere with all the little spheres inside, this was a Cinema 4D screenshot with
okay.
simulated behavior
okay.
in Cinema 4D.
So maybe it's better to work in Cinema 4D with all these kind of...
Depends really on your use case, what you're trying to do. If you're doing motion graphics and you're familiar with Cinema 4D and you're happy with the possibilities inside, then use Cinema 4D. If you want to do like experimental real-time graphics, use VVV. If you want to do like just games, do
okay.
use Unity. It's just the tool for every case.
Okay.
Yeah, you can dive into this kind of document, and you will definitely find some things we are not talking about today. It's basically a look into the future, what will come into VVV in soonish, I hope. I tried to sponsor Vux to push him a little bit to actually implement all this bullet stuff, because I guess he has enough other stuff on his plate. I've got some more examples before we start to patch. Basically, let's start with that one. It's just basically an overview what bullet physics can do. I think it's taken from YouTube. So this is something you're going to be expecting today. You can even do 2D physics with it. So some sort of replacement of box 2D. I think Box2D has its advantages actually. If you really want to go 2D, yeah, just use Box2D. It's some sort simpler at some point. Never thought about it. Never tried really bullet with 2D stuff. This is quite interesting, this part, because this one actually shows all the possible constraints, which are a lot. This video? No, it's just the official bullet line.
Also, the cloth simulation, if possible, something like that.
What
the cloth simulation?
Not yet. It was possible if you downloaded an old version of VVV with the old bullet physics, there's a cloth simulation inside. It's just not the current release. Oh, yeah, my favorite, the bunny. That's a soft body. Yeah. I mean, soft body looks really nice, but you have to know that it's pretty CPU hungry. So it looks nice, but the practical use is kind of limited. No. That's as I said, it's the official bullet release. But I've read something that the next bullet library release will introduce some GPU calculations. So basically, they move the physics library from CPU to GPU, and then I guess it's gonna be really good. And quick. Something I did, which is a bit similar to the stuff we're gonna do today. Just the spherical force, like collecting some balls. Some of you started that patch, if you've seen it. It's like the introduction patch. Pretty simple thing. And of course, the research concerning car physics, which is quite complex, but we're going to look into that today as well. Online, yeah, on the Vimeo channel. And so on. Okay, let's fire up VVV and I would say we start with a blank patch and then go through the notes bit by bit. So, as I said, the first thing we need is a rigid world, because what we simulate today is rigid bodies. So type in rigid world, bullet, and there we go. Sorry? Magnifying. So rigid world starts by default with -9.8 on the y-axis at gravity, so it's already set up. Time step is probably wrong. What I usually do is divide 1/60. I was reading a lot about this kind of time step issue, because like a pro VVV patcher can think, or basically I was thinking, maybe it's more clever to actually sync the time step to VVV, but actually it isn't, because when VVV drops a frame due to like rendering overload, stuff like that, this missing frame would actually cause like trouble in the physics engine. So it's better way to actually have the time step like fixed like this way, running independently from the VVV frequency. So you leave it like that. To make sure that VVV itself runs on 60 frames, I usually add a main loop, set it to 60, and leave it like that. Don't touch iterations, just leave it at 8. I never seen any difference. I tried 1,000 iterations and 1 iterations, it never really made a difference, so whatever, don't care about it. Rigid world should be enabled, of course, and because we going to reset the world quite often, because we set up elements and we want to reset the world to create these kind of elements, what I usually do is add a keyboard node. Keyboard devices desktop, a key match, and set up the key match to the space button via the inspector. So once you've done that, this, you can connect this to the reset pin, and now you have some sort of convenience patch. Pressing space, you can reset the world quite easy. So the next bit is we have two outlets of the node. It's broadcasting world and has reset. So basically giving the information that the world has reset once we press the space bar. For structural reasons, I usually send them globally into the patch. So we need one send of type node. And one send of type value. And name them accordingly, has reset and world. So that's the basic setup. So far, so good. I probably better save the patch to make sure I'm not losing anything. The next task will be we care about the rendering first. What is really, really convenient in that release is before you had to go through all this kind of create body creation and add some shaders and meshes and stuff like that to actually see something. What's really convenient in that release is we have a node called debug draw. You can add that.
Sorry, what?
Debug draw. Or just. And this basically renders an abstraction of the whole physics system. So before you actually care about shaders, meshes, stuff like that, just add in renderer, debug draw, and camera, and you've done. You can start with your bodies. So this is what I'm going to do. I add a renderer since I want everything in aspect ratio. I add an aspect ratio DX11 layer. Maybe a group would be useful. And a camera. Choose whatever camera you like. I usually work with camera Softimage. Big enough for the last row. Is anyone not working with DX11 yet? Some people. It's not that different. It's pretty much the same. It's just a few differences. This one, I guess, is special in case of aspect ratio for all DX9 users, because usually before you had like to connect aspect ratio to the renderer. And yes, now it's just a convenience node to which you put in between, and you're done. Okay, now we have the drawing set up, basically the debug drawing. Let's create our first object, our first body. So when you type in create, you see a couple of different bodies. We can create a dynamic body, we can create a dynamic body persist, we can create a kinematic body or a static body. The difference between the bodies is basically, some are quite obvious. A static body is basically a body which doesn't move. It's just rock solid. It's just can collide with other things, but it doesn't move. Which you usually use for ground. If you have a ground plane, use the static body. You can use for moving and colliding bodies, you can use dynamic body persist. This is actually what I use most, because persist always outputs you the bodies, while the dynamic body not persist only exists in one frame. I'm not really sure what kind of use case you have for this. But I don't. I use basically the persist. I want the stuff there, and I want to work with it. It might be possible that books didn't really implement it right. So I don't know. It's just basically it doesn't output on the create body. It doesn't output in world. It just exists one frame. So I don't know. But one frame. I don't know. So persist is basically it. There is another body, kinematic body. Kinematic body is basically the body which you can move you around yourself. You can basically update its position, and bullet physics tries to calculate all the collisions right with that kind of body, with other dynamic bodies. So kinematic is basically a manual body. All these kind of different bodies, basically before that release, we just had one body node, create body node, and you had a lot of pins to say like it's kinematic, it's not kinematic, it's static, it was madness, and now it's like really clear. You say I want a static body, fine. So we go for this one, create dynamic body persist. And let's look at the node, what this node expects. First pin is world. What am I going to do with that? Any suggestion?
Receive
of type node. Receive world. In the most recent VVV release, receive automatically chooses world. So you just connect that. And we have on the other side, we have do create. Let's be lazy and get another receive of type value and connect to has reset. So every time we reset the world, we just create a body. Second input pin, shapes. Any idea what we can connect to that? Maybe let's type in shapes. What does the node browser say? This is not helpful. Okay, we have to know the shapes. Simplest one is box. Box Bullet. Note to myself, say tell Wux he needs to put the tag shape in it. Box 4 Taurus, Capsule, BVH, Height Field, that's about it. Most of the stuff you can do with BVH, because BVH is like the all-purpose node which can like use meshes. Sorry? Yeah, with BVH, showing later. We import it in a landscape, which is like an FBX file, which I made in Cinema 4D. You just load it and you've done, basically. Okay, Box has some parameters, which are basically defining like the shape itself. Let's start here. Basically, size is the most interesting, because size basically defines how big is your box and how does it look. Is it flat or large or small or whatever. So let's make an IO box out of that. Left click, middle click. The rest of the pins of the shape we don't actually need, except mass, of course. Mass is self-explanatory how heavy the object is.
Sorry, what's the difference between the size pin and the scaling pin?
You can actually scale it additionally to the size, so it's stupid. Don't need it. But usually I leave it like that. More interesting is the post pin. The shape node box has a post pin, and the create dynamic body has a post pin. Yeah. So basically, the idea of the post is basically to set up the initial position of the body where it's actually created. You can sort of give the shape itself an initial position, but it doesn't really make sense. I wouldn't just touch this one. I would always use the pose pin on the create dynamic body. So what you do is basically add a pose node. You can connect this one to the pose pin of the create dynamic body, and the rest should be pretty obvious. The post pin has a position x, y, z, and that gives you basically the initial position of the physics body.
What's the mass of the box? What is it representing in the real world?
It's not really... The thing is, there might be a bug inside or not. Basically, when you define a car inside the bullet physics, you can use like real life parameters, like you say you type in 800 and it means like 800 kilograms. So it's pretty, that works quite well. When you use the mass pin on the box shape and you put it to 800, it seems like it sticks with one. It's not getting any heavier after one. So I can't really make up what kind of how heavy it is. What I usually do is I set up my shapes in between 0 and 1 and work with gravity.
Yeah.
If everything is too light, and then I just increase gravity to some insane amount. Actually, the mass pin introduces some problems. I've tried one thing in the demo patch I've gave you with the pinball. Basically, when you define a pad, a hinge, with the mass higher than one, then it doesn't really work. So probably it's better to leave that at 1 or below 1. Negative mass, of course, doesn't make sense, doesn't work. So something in between 0 and 1. A question concerning the pose. We can set up the position and we can set up the orientation, rotation, but it expects the rotation in quaternions. If you want to set it up with jaw till roll, what kind of node do you need before that?
I didn't understand the question.
You didn't understand the question. Usually, when you set up the rotation, like with Transform 3D, you have pitch, jaw, and roll. Euler, yeah. So just for you guys, in case you want to set up the orientation, get an Euler node, and you can have jaw tilt roll, and it outputs quaternions. So it's just a convenience node to actually set up the pose. So I would expect actually a body to fall down already, but I don't see anything. Ah, yeah. Cheers. Okay, when you fix that one, I missed world debug draw, press space, you should see some box falling down. If not, raise your arm. Everyone all right? Red boxes all over the place. Perfect. So now our box falls into infinity, so it would make sense to introduce just a simple plane, so a simple ground, where the box can fall onto it. So we need a new create. What kind of create node? Dynamic, kinematic, static. No, in this case we use plane. Ah, no, new shape. Didn't mention that. Create static body persist. Zoom in. So here as well, business as usual, we need a world receiver. We need has reset. We need a plane. This one, plane bullet. And basically the normal input pin of the plane defines how the plane is rotated. If you have a normal at on the y axis at 1, it's basically a plane like you expect, like a ground.
The plane is circumvented by the developer, right?
Sorry?
The plane is not circumvented by the
developer. No, it's not by that. But you will see it, like basically your box won't fall down anymore if it's there. Mm-hmm. And if I'm not mistaken, the plane is infinite in any direction. So. So a lot of clicking doesn't mean you're still catching, you're creating boxes.
I don't have any plane.
Sorry?
I don't have any plane.
You don't have a
plane? Yes.
Maybe it's a the next bit will be actually the drawing, because right now, okay, we see a box, but maybe we wanted to render the box in a nice or a nicer way. So how are we going to do that? So instead of using the debug draw, which only is helpful like to check out if everything is there and simulating right, we want to draw it now with the shader. Like you can use the func shader, point, direction, whatever. One thing to note here is basically you have to use a mesh to actually render something. You can't just get the mesh out of the physics engine, you have to use your own mesh. So what we need for the box is a box mesh, which is called box DX11 geometry. So to render this mesh, of course, we need a shader. Let's take a simple one, Phong directional. Connect the box to it and connect it to the renderer. So this kind of drawing doesn't know anything about the physics engine yet. What is necessary to connect the both. It's just a box and a shader. Uh-huh. Not two nodes. So the good news actually is, compared to the early bullet implementation and let's say Box2D, getting the transformation out of the physics engine is in this case stupid simple. The node just is called get body transform. So no crazy shit with getting out the position and the rotation and stuff like that and just gluing it together to a transformation again. You just get body transform and you connect it. With one little exception. So you can do it that way. And the exception is basically rotation and position is basically going through that stream, but not size. So what you usually have to do is connect the size of the shape to the size of the mesh. That's it. Just remember that. Size of the shape, of the bullet shape, connect that to the size of the mesh.
But if you change the transforming property on the box, the bullet box, does it affect to the size?
Not directly, because you have to create the body again. Basically, the size only matters on creation. And then, so you have to kill it at first and then define a new size. So you can try this. Let's make this a little bit more tidy now. Something like that way. It's quite convenient. You could actually make a module out of it, like a box basically, which has physics inside and can draw. It's quite concise construction. So let's check this out. Let's make it a bit bigger and start the pose maybe a little bit higher. Try this.
Can you see a bit of why it's shifting?
Ah, that's the debug draw. Can turn this off. Yeah, have fun with that. I usually use Max Debug Draw mode.
Yes.
Yeah. It's my same experience. You have to use some sort of rasterizer options to make some of the modes are visible. So don't bother. A little bit of depth buffer and anti-aliasing would be nice. Depth buffer, standard. For anyone who hasn't used DX11 yet, check out the inspector of the renderer. You can set up the depth buffer to standard and AA samples per pixel to 4 or 8 or whatever your graphics card can manage. So this is basically the basic setup to start actually things to build. An idea would be now to give you like 10 minutes, and you can use your skills in spreading to actually make more than this one object. Parameters for spreading are obviously the position, the pose, and the scaling. You could, for example, try to build a wall out of blocks, stuff like that. Be creative, 10 minutes. And if some questions come up. No, it makes totally sense because otherwise it's pretty unstable. Okay, no creative mode. Two more nodes we look at. The two nodes which are actually still missing to define the body is basically friction and restitution. And to look at my material. Yeah, these options were basically pins before this release. Like the create body had these kind of options on the create body node, but this one is like is now optional, and it's called dynamics properties. There's only one place where you can connect these properties, and this gives you the power basically to set up the friction of the object. So zero friction means really slippy, friction one, sticky. Restitution, again, I would only set it up in between zero and one. It's like how bouncy the object is. Rolling friction is quite special because this parameter wasn't there before in the old release. It's very important, basically, how like rotating objects, what kind of friction they have, and this made like some constructs really unstable when you don't set up this parameter. But again, something in between zero and one.
And the friction too, right?
Yeah, again. Dynamics properties. Let me zoom in. Some more options. Is active. Let me check something. Is active, I don't really see a point for that, but maybe you can have an idea. It's basically when we put that to zero, it just exists, but it doesn't collide with anything.
We should apply it also to the static body. Should we apply it to the static body as well?
You could, yeah, you could, of course. Has contact response, says basically does it collide. And debug view enabled, of course.
Thank you.
definitely some instability going on, like it's like really fast moving objects and restitution.
Mm-hmm.
But this is not a VGV problem.
Right.
When you check out the bullet library, it does similar things.
Okay.
Actually, the video I was showing today with the bullet examples, when you really closely look at the pyramids and the walls they were building, it's pretty similar when you're shooting some pictures and it gets really shaky.
Yeah, it seems weird.
But what you usually do is like when you create something, you want it to stand still, but like let it fall down. When it doesn't fall down, and you play with the structure. Let something collide.
But then how do you make it stand still?
You can create the boxes just above the ground.
Exactly, like precisely.
Yeah, precisely. Yeah, another trick which while you are building things, you can play around with another node which you can connect and get more parameters, which is called motion properties. Motion properties allow you to set an initial velocity and an initial angular velocity. So once you create the body, it can actually already fly into one direction. Not just driven by gravity, but basically by a momentum by itself.
Thank you.
In case you want to use like a module by me, if I've done this little Jenga tower module, which you can just drop in. It's basically in the modules folder. Workshop modules. There you've got this Jenga generate module, which just basically generates like position and rotation data to create this kind of tower. Drag drop in and use scaling translate and rotate.
Because that's a different
it's
patch.
Basically a module. We've got a modules folder, and there's a module inside which is called Jenga generate, and it basically generates
it's
size,
this thing.
Position, and rotation to make stuff like that. It's just an example. You can be creative yourself and do your own spreading.
Okay.
It's just an example of what you can do with a simple setup.
Thank you. Okay, if there aren't any questions, I would propose you save that patch, any location, and we make another patch upon the structure of this patch. Basically, save the situation, and we're going to change this one.
Damit die Boxen nicht irgendwie runterfallen.
Also okay.
Müssen ja irgendwo liegen bleiben.
Das ist plain.
Plain ist halt der Boden.
Ah, okay. Ah,
sonst, wenn, kannst du es ja mal probieren, mach mal Plain einfach aus, was passiert dann?
Ah, okay, und dann müssen die dann runterfallen. Dann
fallen die einfach runter. In die Unendlichkeit. Shall we proceed, or Thomas, ist das ein größeres Problem, oder? Thomas, gibt bei dir die mittlere Maustaste hier irgendwie? Welches? Was?
Hier ist eine Taste.
Kannst du das bedienen? Mach mal, ich bin hier. Ich will das Patch schließen, anders aufmachen.
Ja?
Mach zu. Einfach ausmachen den Quatsch und dann nochmal das Magnet aufmachen.
Das ist der hier. Okay, let's proceed. What we're gonna do now is basically exchange the box with the sphere. What I'm trying to do is basically the initial graphics to do with a simple force, which is sort of like working like a magnet and dragging all these spheres into one place. So let's get off Jenga generate and reset this one, reset this one. Still have a spread somewhere. What's going on? Ah, yeah. For this scenario, we don't need the plane. So you don't have to delete the plane. It's just enough to just disconnect the has reset pin, so the plane doesn't get created. Next bit will be, let's switch the box for a sphere. So we need to exchange the sphere bullet. And of course, since we want to render a sphere as well, we have to switch the box mesh with a sphere mesh. Well, sphere DX11 geometry. So let's check this out, if this works. You should get this one. Sphere falling down. So basic example. Any idea what I could do to make the sphere not fall down? Turn off the gravity, yeah. So let's switch to gravity and say gravity is zero, so our sphere is there, doesn't fall down, all is good. What do I have to do to create with this kind of setup more than one sphere? And basically I want like randomly distributed spheres.
Spread the pulse.
Spread the pulse, yeah. So let's get a random spread. What I usually do is conveniently use an iNode connected to the random seed, set it to 3, so I get a vector 3 out of it and just set up the spread count to whatever number. So basically just two additional nodes, an iNode and a random spread to get more than one sphere, spreading the pose. So let's make some more. What we could actually do is spread the size as well. So to make it a little bit more interesting. So let's get another random spread. In this case, just a standard random spread connected to the spread count. So we have like in this case, like 52 values. Connect this to the radius of this bullet sphere and connect it to the radius of the geometry sphere. So it looks basically like that. You don't have to do that, it's basically just to make it more interesting to have like... Wait, let me fix that first and then... Okay, this is position and this is size.
Does your random spread put out negative sizes as well?
No, I basically changed the input value of random spread to 1 and then the width to either also to 1 so I don't get negative sizes. that is what I really like about VVV. Just get a random generator, connect it, and get more of everything. Adding a force to this construction is pretty simple. You basically just add the node apply force, which has to know about the bodies, of course. So let's do that. Apply force. And since I said like on the left input pin we need bodies, it's pretty obvious that we have to connect this one. There are the bodies coming out of create body, because this is basically the place where we create the bodies, and this is the place where we get the bodies. Can do a lot more intricate stuff and like give bodies a name and filter bodies so you don't apply force to all of the bodies which are created at this place, but I try to keep it simple at this place or at this point in time, and just we apply the force to all bodies created. So we get the bodies, we have apply force, and when you look at apply force, it's kind of simple. You have a vector for force, and you have a pin apply. So what you can do is like toggle apply to on and give something, some value at the force vector, and you should see something. It basically behaves at the moment right pretty similar to gravity right now. But the difference to gravity at this point in time. Am I too fast? Who's still catching up?
Yeah, mine are
few people. I just added apply force, nothing else. The difference between apply force and gravity basically always works on the world, on everything. It doesn't make a distinction between like objects. Apply force, since we are using a spread here, apply force can apply to certain slices. Each object can has its own apply force. So by feeding in a spread into apply force, we can basically send each sphere to some other place. I prepared a convenience node for you, which basically what it does is basically calculating a force vector for each sphere and trying to drag each sphere into a certain point, into a center. So let's check that out. When you look into the modules folder, you see a spherical force. It's basically just number crunching. It doesn't have nothing specifically with bullet physics to do, but it's basically a convenience patch to create the numbers. So what we're gonna do is, and maybe you can help me with that, spherical force, I drop it in, minimize the patch or the module, and let's go through the pins. What might be center XYZ?
Center of gravity.
Yeah, it's a point where everything is basically trying to get to. Body XYZ. This is probably going to be the position of the bodies. So we have to get some way to get the XYZ coordinates out of the physics engine. We have a range, basically the range of the magnet. If things are too far away, then they are not within the range. And the strength, of course. You can make, I'm sure you can make a negative strength as well, so like push things away from the center.
So that's calculating a vector with points from each.
It's exactly, from the center point to each position of the body, it calculates a vector to get the force. So applied force on its own is pretty boring, actually. It's basically what kind of numbers you're feeding in. So let's do that. We're going to leave center XYZ as it is. Don't touch that. Maybe let's visualize it and say like 3D vector. It's just set up at position 0, 0, 0. And the same as apply force to make it like dynamic. We can connect the force already with force. without knowing the bullet physics engine, does anyone has an idea how to get the position already?
Decompose.
Decompose, exactly. You could use decompose on the get body transform. On the other hand, there's a node which is, have to look it up, get body details or something. Get rigid body details, that's the name. Get rigid body details, this one outputs all the parameters of the rigid bodies, including x, y, z position. Get rigid body details is the node, or what?
I found one called get body pose, and it gives you the...
get body pose, yeah, of course, yeah. So there are a couple of ways to get the x, y, z coordinates out of it. Yeah, good hint. It's quite concise. Let's take get body pose.
Could you throw to less fixed than the other
one? No.
So is the force applied per body?
Yeah, it's applied per body because we're feeding in now the bodies are spreaded and we're feeding in a spreaded force, so each body gets its own force. Connect get body pose position into body XYZ, and this should be it. So the bodies are trying to stick at the center to some extent. Let's make it a little bit tidy for everyone. So we turned on applied force. We have a center position. We get the position into the convenience patch. And it looks like that.
Thank you.
if you want to use this called tilted plane, do you use a box for that one plane? It's actually just a convenience word for all the other things.
Would it be okay for everybody if we make a 5-minute break and then go into the car example? So to freshen up the batteries. Tatsächlich über diese Kinematic-Body. Da kannst du mal in das Beispiel reingucken, und das habe ich dir heute ganz gut geliefert, und zwar das mit dem Pinball. Da ist so ein rotierender Kreisel in der Mitte auf dem Pinball
hier. Ah, ja.
Und den steuere ich durch den LFO. Das heißt, die Bewegung kommt von außen und die macht nicht die Physik irgendwie, sondern force die halt irgendwie rein sozusagen. Und das wäre halt eine Möglichkeit, halt irgendwie, das ist halt eine Kinematic-Body, die man halt irgendwie selber steuern kann. Und der dann, wo dann die Physik-Engine versucht, halt den korrekt zu verrechnen. Das wäre halt eine Möglichkeit, halt über den
okay.
Halt eine Fläche halt irgendwie machen zu lassen.
Und ist das dann, also wäre das dann...
Geht auf jeden Fall besser, auf jeden Fall also als Box.
Ja, yeah. Okay. Wäre das dann eigentlich so ein... also das ist kein statischer Body, kein static Body, eigenes Body. Die haben bei den Bodenringen ein statisches... Ich meine, es ist ein bisschen problematisch, die Größe zu ändern. Also wenn man jetzt mit dem Ball beispielsweise hätte einen Ball in der Mitte, der irgendwie so pulsiert auf Sound und würde dann die
Größe ändern ist tatsächlich in Physiksimulationen ein Riesenproblem. Weil das Physiksimulationen funktionieren eigentlich immer so, dass sie halt eigentlich auch immer die vergangenen Frames betrachten, die vergangenen Bilder, die sozusagen berechnet haben. Und dann versucht halt daraus halt irgendwie auch die Zukunft zu projizieren. Okay, der Ball ist jetzt in den letzten Frames halt irgendwie die Richtung geflogen. Da kommt jetzt gleich eine Wand, also muss er damit kollidieren. Jeder manuelle Eingriff in das System bedeutet irgendwas, was die Physik-Engine nicht antizipieren kann.
Also Bullen kann das nicht.
Keine Physik-Engine kann das wirklich. Oder du musst halt irgendwie du baust eine Latenz ein in das System, dass es halt irgendwie immer, sagen wir mal, 10 Frames hinterherhinkt, um sozusagen antizipieren. Was du da machst, um mal halt anderen Sachen darauf reagieren zu lassen. Das ist halt einfach dieses Zukunftsproblem. Halt. Mit Positionen und so weiter geht das noch so gerade so. Mit Size haben sie, glaube ich, bewusst rausgenommen, weil das eben auch so die Diplomatik ist. Wenn du jetzt manuell sagst, halt irgendwie, das Ding ist jetzt so groß und im nächsten Film, zack, ist das so groß, dann kann das sein, dass auf einmal Objekte da drin stecken. Das ist meine Welt. Der kann diese Bewegung antizipieren, die du wahrscheinlich irgendwie weißt, dass du die machen willst, aber...
Also kann das jetzt... politisch, okay. Ein schönes Feature.
Gut. Du kannst aber, auf der anderen Seite kannst du vielleicht auch ein bisschen drumherum arbeiten, weil, wie gesagt, du hast ja immer die Möglichkeit, dass du Körper durch vordefinierte Bullet-Objekte halt irgendwie erzeugst. Also im Prinzip kann ja auch ein Körper aus mehreren Kugeln bestehen, die du miteinander verbindest. Und du kannst die Kugeln auseinander. Das ist immer der Unterschied zwischen dem, was du simulierst und was du letztendlich zeichnest, was du darstellst. Du kannst ja sagen, okay, dein Objekt besteht eigentlich in der Physikwelt aus Kugeln, definiert so seine Begrenzung, aber zeichnen tust du was anderes. Und da hast du ein bisschen die Möglichkeit, dass du, wenn du die Kugeln weiter auseinander schiebst, hast du ja eine gewisse Begrenzung und eine Größe, die du steuern kannst. Und irgendwie ein bisschen drumherum arbeiten kann man das schon.
Okay.
Negatives Skalierung auf den Meshes, sie einfach nach außen stülpen, auch im Rendering vom Mesh. Mhm. Lohnt sich die ganze Zeit gefragt, wieso sind die Kugeln hier schwarz und dann weiß? So, du hast dann das Bett in Form stehen. Also, nee.
Ich weiß gar nicht, ob ich hier eigentlich wirklich eine Software brauche. Tschüss. Also bleiben wir dabei. Gut, machen wir erstmal Terrain. Terrain ist ein.
Weil mit dem Quadrat von mir auch die von 2015, ja. Und inzwischen haben sie Fragen nur mal an den Dezember 2016.
Ja, aber das hat schon Museumswert, ne?
Ja.
Oder da waren schon ein paar andere Kündigungsversionen dazwischen.
Ich glaube, 2019 kaufte man dann ein Leitgerechner.
Das war ein langen Lichtgerechner.
Also zwei Winter haben halt recht. Und so zum Surfen in den letzten Mal zwei Minuten. Aber da haben wir
es gibt auch ein Kippis mehr. Und so ein Kippis lassen wir uns auch.
Okay, let's get into car physics. The first step would be...
Just wanted to ask to show the tweaks on your special forces, because when we play around, it always gets wobbly and never hits the center somehow.
These are range 10, 4, 7. You have to, maybe you have to set up the friction a little bit higher, so. And the restitution low, so it doesn't get bouncy.
There is no way kind of to ease out the force after
something. The problem is, even in that situation, they're still trying to get to the center.
Yeah.
So it's quite exotic that they are standing still.
Okay.
So I would expect they move until infinity. So the first step, setting up our car, is really simple. Select everything except the world, and this, and delete. The second step will be the introduction of the BVH node, which actually allows you to import any mesh you can create with Cinema 4D, 3D Max, whatever, 3D package, to actually create a bullet object. One note here, basically, you have, when you define these kind of meshes, you usually tend to make them like really low resolution. Don't import like a 1 million polygon mesh into your bullet physics, because that will break your machine, probably. To make the patch a little bit more tidy, I tend to use modules here. So the third step would be creating a subpatch. I usually use the key command Control Shift P. And then save that to your desired location and name that landscape or whatever. Landscape, terrain.
What was the shortcut again?
Control Shift P.
Ah.
Create some submodule as a node. So we end up with the node itself. After we saved it, I've saved it named as landscape, and I'm gonna dock this patch, Alt, left click, the basic VVVV user interface wonders. Okay, let's get the mesh into the subpatch. Loading a mesh, how would you load a mesh in DX11? Is one way and another? Scene file, exactly. Scene file gives you a little bit more information. We need that information here. So it's a scene file. I magnify a little bit. And the interesting bits of scene file are, of course, the file name. Let's load the file, which is located in your bullet project folder, somewhere here, workshop, landscape, terrain FBX. This is basically the standard Cinema 4D terrain, which you just can create by create terrain, done. Okay, this one is loaded. Next in question is let's render the mesh. So we get the node mesh geometry assemb. Get the shader from directional. Create an output for the module, name it. Done. For creating this kind of landscape, what kind of body would be suitable? Kinematic, dynamic, static? Static. Create static body persist. So the create static body persist obviously does need to know about the world again, so get a receive node. Get a receive node for here has reset again. And now comes the cool part, how are we going to get the mesh into the create static body. The node is called VVH bullet assemb, so it's compatible with the assemb nodes. You may ask what BVH stands for, I don't know. It just works. Okay, we connect the second output mesh to BVH. And let's focus on the scaling. Because I guess the landscape I made in Cinema is too big, so we have to scale it down. But when we scale it down, we have to scale down the position values as well and everything. So the best way to do that is, let's get scaling here. This is scaling. Let's set it up like this. 0.6, 0.6, 0.6, something like that. How do we get the transformation out of create static body? How do we get the transformation out? Get pose is a position. No, I want the get body transform. So get body transform. And now, since we scaled down the mesh here, we have to scale down the position and rotation stuff as well. So we get a scale vector, scale transform vector, and just connect the scaling from the BVH to the scale transform vector. So basically, something like that. Looks still tidy to me. And I guess we should be done here. Connect the transformation after scale to the shader itself, and let's create and see if we see something. No, we don't see anything because we haven't connected the module to the group yet. Showing you the is someone not seeing the landscape after finishing that sub patch? In the main patch, in the root patch, the landscape. And then press space and you should see the mesh. In case I move the object, I have the possibility to actually move the terrain or the landscape a little bit down or do something with it. So to make sure it's in the right position, it makes it more dynamic. So for editing. Anyone who actually finished this already, you can experiment with this landscape already. You can create a dynamic body, throw some balls at the landscape, and they should collide with the landscape already. Try that. You have two rigid worlds, basically two worlds which are independent from another. They're independent.
But you have to set the same nodes with different IDs.
Yeah, of course. Sure.
You can't use BVH to dynamic body.
It is a dynamic body. No, you can't? Actually, I never tried with that release. Might be possible. Yeah, maybe not. It's not working.
No.
Okay.
Working.
Would be awesome if you could try to patch this from out of your head, basically. Create a dynamic sphere which is basically falling down onto the BBH landscape. If you have questions or problems, ask. You could use both actually. You could use DX11 with the bullet physics, just for the physics,
yeah.
And use DX9 with like X-File or Collada loader to actually render in DX9.
I would have to export it or there's no way that I generate a mesh, let's say a plane. And
from DX11 to DX9?
No, from DX9, so from DX9 into a create button.
Warum willst du das?
Weil ich auch DirectX11 ist, würde ich mal schnell so ein Plane machen mit einem Curly neues und dann einfach sagen, okay, mach draus ein Body.
Wenn du das machen willst, da gibt es das Height-Field. Und wenn du dir das Height-Field-Example mal vom Bullet anguckst, mach genau das. Da gibt es auch Perle Noise, Height-Field. Okay. I don't care. Still. Okie dokie. Let's make the car. To build the car is actually a lot more complicated because you have to set up the chassis, you have to set up the wheels, suspensions, like really a lot of parameters. Although with this release it's a lot easier than it was before and it simulates quite stable. To do all that I would suggest that we create a subpatch again, like a module, Control Shift P, save it as My Mercedes. And to create a car is basically create, what's it called, vehicle. So that's basically the base node, which doesn't do much yet. It basically just defines the chassis of the car. Yeah, sure. So I did a subpatch called my car, my Mercedes. Inside the subpatch, we have create vehicle. And now we have to add, of course, again the world, because the create node needs to know the world. And it would be nice if we have a has reset as well. Again, business as usual. It just repeats. The best object for the chassis I would propose is a box, of course, nothing complicated. So we take box bullet. And I've given you some settings of the car. Let's say it's like 1, it's not very high. And let's say it's like something like 4 long. So to set up the position, we need pose again. So this is nothing new, just repeats all over again. Pose, I would propose you use like a sort of high value on the y-axis, so actually the car gets generated above the landscape and not somewhere below. So let's say let's try 5 or something. Might fall down a lot, we check that later. So I guess we managed that. It's nothing complicated yet. Now comes the sort of complicated part, because we want to define the wheels. What's really cool is you can define vehicles with 3 wheels, 2 wheels, 4 wheels. You can make a tank, doesn't matter. Today we could just concentrate on a standard car with 4 wheels. The node for that is called construction properties. In brackets, bullet wheel. There's only one inlet where it fits. And let's go through the pins. We have local position. This is basically where the wheels are after creation. We have wheel radius, which is pretty obvious what that is. We have wheel width, obvious as well. Suspension, resting length, and is front wheel. Suspension is basically how flexible the car is.
Can wheels all have different sizes?
They can, but then you get a car which probably falls over. depends. You can make a tractor, doesn't matter. You can spread all these parameters and do like crazy cars. Okay. Of course. So let's make a spread for which is easy for is front wheel. Let's make a spread of 4 values because we want to do 4 wheels. So let's get the inspector. Calls row pages 4 rows and say. The first 2 values are the front wheels. So next bit is we'll be going to define the position of the wheels, which is just basic spread. So what we can do is like do it visually with a cons node. So like having cons spreads, set it to working magnified is some funky thing here. Cons. What the fuck? Interesting. Yeah, you sure? Yeah, true. It's cons 3D. And do something like that. Front wheels, back wheels. And what I usually do is I add some sort of offset to the wheels, so it makes it makes the tweaking of the car a little bit more easier. So I add another vector to it, so I can easily move the cars up and down. Vector 3D join plus. And going into construction properties. So this is basically it. This is my little offset. And now let's give the wheels some numbers. It's 1, 2, -1, 2, 1. Magnify a little in a little bit and -1, -2. Nee, das sollen sie jetzt aktuell erbauen.
Ja, aber mit dem Ganzen. Ich glaube, das sieht man schon deutlich genug, die Zahlen, aber manche sind irgendwo den.
Wie habe ich den gemacht?
Ja, wollte ich das Ganze runter ausgehen. Nur ein bisschen, also dass du ein bisschen merken, wenn man es liest. Zoom doch raus.
Ja, links.
Nee, mehr
rechts. Nee, links.
So ein bisschen mit.
Das ist wie mit diesem Gift mit der Toilette, ne? Can we proceed with drawing the chassis? There's nobody saying no, so business as usual, get body transform. Wrong pin, this one. We need a box, geometry, which should have the same size as the physics box. So we connect the size again, get a shader, phong, directional, transform in, box in, layer out, and connect it to the group. And once you've done that, you can reset your scene and you should see some red or some box driving on your landscape. Ah, there's something going on. Let's give it another color.
Thank you.
Sorry? Gravity is still again minus 9. Ja, minus 9.8 Meter pro Sekunde. Nichts Besonderes eigentlich. So, as mentioned before, the idea is actually when you render the car later, you use this transformation to actually render a high polygon car, but the animation looks right, so you don't render the box, this is just for demonstration purposes. Let's render the wheels. The wheels are actually coming out of this pin. No, they aren't. No, yes, they are. You need the node wheel properties. Stupid me, not properties, we already used properties, wheel transform. So here's the transformation of the wheels, and the rest should be business as usual again. Get what would be the best shape for wheels? Cylinder, third cylinder, yeah. Cylinder DX9 geometry. Let's set up radius, and radius is equals, and length, these two parameters, you could connect them to these parameters, just don't do that now, let me get the values. So the wheel radius is something like that, and the wheel width is something like that. So basically I just copied the parameters which I've set up there, here at the cylinder. You could make a connection, of course, just I'm not doing this right now to keep it tidy.